Hello and welcome to News and Views, a program where we discuss the challenges facing our state with the leaders helping us meet those issues. I'm John Banville. Our guest this week is Senator Golden. Senator Golden, thank you very much for being here.
John, good to be here with you, my friend.
We have spoken in the past about all the good things that have been happening in the government. Last year, you closed a $10 billion budget deficit without raising taxes. You did it through a series of common sense spending reductions. You passed a budget on time. There were many good things that came out of last year's legislative session that helped create jobs. Recently, Governor Andrew Cuomo had his State of the State address where he said, again, the major issue is jobs, 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 jobs. Senator Golden, can you tell me where you stand on some of these proposals and what you think of the overall tone of the governor's State of the State, and segue it into where you think that will go with his budget?
Well, I agree that I think the governor's State of the State was a good first step. Now, obviously, it's to negotiate that and to get that passed in the state legislature so that it can become law and create those jobs that we talk about. The out of the ashes came the 9/11. Today we see a floor going up there almost every other day. We see the Atlantic Yards. We see the Nets Stadium coming together. We've seen the 7th Avenue line and the 2nd Avenue line and the East Side Access. We see this work already created and over the past year and past couple of years, which is starting to put some people back to work. But we have real unemployment issues here across our city, across my community. The people in my communities in Bay Ridge and Marine Park and Garrison Beach and unemployed, and we're worried that where am I going to get that money to pay my mortgage? What is my job going? Is my job going to be here next year? Is it going to be here 5 months from now? Am I going to be able to pay my rent? Am I able to send my child to the best college or to the best schools? That struggle is still going on. That pit in everybody's stomach is still there. So I believe that the State of the State gave us something to be proud of and to give us some hope. Besides the projects that are presently going, we've talked about the Jacob Javits Center, about becoming another Battery Park City where we can have housing and actual businesses that will be part of that great complex. We see the Hudson Yards, which is about to be probably over the next couple of weeks, will sign a $4 billion deal that will help us to rebuild that area. We see Moynihan Station, another area that we're going to see some work there as well. You see the aqueduct with the gambling. Gambling was long overdue. It was going to happen. It's in all the states that surround us. People do it with the bookie. They do it all over. So it was about time we took our head out of the sand and give opportunity for gambling to take place here in the city. So Aqueduct is looking to build a larger convention center. We'll have 3,000 rooms. That's a lot of work. You can't get into that Racino today. It is loaded with people going in, and I'm hearing a lot of winners coming out, which is good, and that creates jobs. We're going to see more, obviously, Belmont. We're going to see what's going on at Empire out in Yonkers. We got to see what's going to continue to go on. I do believe that the Aqueduct, having that convention center, is a good idea, but I still think we could have a convention center at the Jacob Javits Center and still go right over the West Side Highway right out to the water and still be able to get that magnificent Battery Park City type of atmosphere at that location and to create those jobs. The $25 billion that he spoke of, the governor, and being able to bring in $10 billion of that from public authorities or from the state itself, but the other 15 coming from private entities, private businesses, coming in and partaking and getting involved. And he didn't just stay here in the city. He went to Buffalo. He went to the wine area. He went across western and eastern New York and upstate New York. And he actually came up with a plan that I think will start to generate jobs. But as I said, it's a flatlined economy for the next year and a half or so. So it's going to take a struggle. By the time permits are given and by the time we get the right bids out there and the right people come up and step up and take these different acquisitions on for the future, it's going to take time. And that's what I'd like to see that expedited that process. And we see that with New York Works, and where we're going to have the ability to go in there with public-private partnerships and build the Tappan Zee Bridge, build 1,000, 2,000 areas of roadway and bridges and tunnels that will give us the economic development and the jobs that we need to spur that economic development, not just here in the city, not just in Buffalo, but in the wine area, the eastern and western New York, but right across the state of New York. And I think those are areas that this governor talked about, and that came through real leadership. And I think that at the end of the day, we will be not only the city and state that gets through this tough economic times, but it'll probably be the leading state in the nation in creating those jobs that we need to be able to put people back to work.
Do you, you mentioned the New York Works Fund, which is one of the projects that would be in charge of the Tappan Zee Bridge. And apparently it will also be either replacing or upgrading over 100 bridges. And it will be done with this public-private partnership. As a former businessman, do you find that government, the philosophy of government is now, we are here to help? Because there was a period of time where that could have been considered a joke. Do you think that where government would come in and set floors and prices and things like that, do you feel that this government has the ability to work with local governments and with the various unions and the employees to make sure that everything can come together? That would be a huge change.
I believe the best thing for government is to get out of the way of business, local businesses and larger corporate America type businesses, and coming in to do these acquisitions. What we should be doing is setting up the opportunity for that to happen. We should be getting rid of the regulations that impede this type of work to happen here in our city, in our state. And when we do that, and we understand that, it's like gambling coming to the state of New York. We don't belong in gambling. We're a state. We have no expertise in gambling whatsoever. Give it to the people, the experts that come in here, put plans on a table, find out who the best people are, give it to them, and take the money that's coming into the cities, the states, the towns, the villages for education. Take that money. And you know what? We're talking about not the tune of a couple of hundred thousand. We're talking to the tune of billions and billions of dollars. Same thing with OTB. You see, OTB is closed in the city of New York. We have no, not only horse racing in the city of New York, but we have no sports gambling. We should have sports gambling, and we should have horse racing. It should be opened in a different environment and with a different plan, business plan, that concept that would work and allow to put more people to work, allow the OT people that lost their jobs to get their jobs back, and allow for the future of that area, which I think is, we're talking about 1,000 jobs, and we're talking about another $1 billion in economic activity. So there's money out there that can be had. It's up to us to recognize how to do that, get out of the way of business, let business come in and do what they do best. And that's one business. And then we should reap the rewards from that. The rewards of that are jobs, jobs, jobs. And that's what the people in my community want. And that's who I work for. I work for the people in my community, and I want to continue to do that.
Out of curiosity, I'd like to shift gears for one moment. One of your current, or your former jobs was that of a New York City police officer. And your job was to protect all law-abiding citizens. One of the proposals Governor Cuomo has come up with is an expansion of the DNA data bank. Now, that's been around since, I believe, 94. And it's been amended maybe three times. But the governor wants to open it up to all crimes. As a former law enforcement officer, where do you stand on that?
We're in the 21st century. And if we're in a 21st century, we should be doing what you do in a 21st century, using 21st century technology with 21st century environment of good, hardworking investigators and people within law enforcement. If somebody is guilty of a crime of rape or homicide, and that person's been taken and pulled over and arrested for a misdemeanor, Are we kidding ourselves that we can't take a swab and check to find out if that person is responsible for crime? That's crazy. That's absurd. It's like when I think about the Medicaid and the Medicare and the welfare fraud that goes on within our city and our state. Everybody in the world knows that it's in Kings County. That's the capital of the entire nation. Queens and the Bronx and Westchester follow. So wouldn't you think we'd be able to come up with 21st century technology, 21st century investigators, do overlays, find out who these people are, who's doing these prescription pills that are killing our kids, this OxyContin, and how they're doctor shopping and how they're working around and getting these pharmacies and getting this OxyContin. We have to be able to get into the 21st century. We're not. And you know who I blame? I blame the legislature. The legislature should have allowed this to happen a long time ago. How many children have died because of OxyContin? How many people are out there because it could have had a DNA check and we didn't do it, and that person killed an innocent child or a family? I mean, it's just ludicrous that we're not doing what we should be doing as representatives of the people of our community. So I'm happy for this good governor for his leadership in this area. I'm hoping that the assembly comes along and that we get this accomplished. And I think at the end of the day, what are you going to say? Crime come down. Families safer, more secure. When people have a quality of life that they can talk about and feel good about, and that pit in their stomach is gone, that public safety is good, the transportation is getting better, they're able to send the kids to the best schools and get the best education that they can have and that they want for their children, and that they're not concerned about their jobs and whether that job's going to be here tomorrow or it's going to be gone. That's what we got to get back to. That's the America I knew. And that's the America that the people in my community and the people across the city and state want. So we need to bring that back. And I think we can do that with this governor and hopefully with this legislature and give that people back the confidence that they need in this great state.
You spend a lot of time traveling around the Brooklyn, basically meeting your constituents and finding out what they need. Do you feel that there's a sense of hope that is starting to return? Do they understand how government not taking all these taxes from them affects their quality of life, that they'll have more money? Are people starting to see an improvement, or do you feel that there's going to be more time?
I think time. I think what we've done last year and not being able to raise taxes and fees and to balance a $10 billion budget. If you remember, it was only a year before we raised $13 billion under a different governor at the new taxes and fees in the worst economic times that this nation has ever seen since the Great Depression. So people are still a little wary of government. We see what's going on in Washington, D.C., and they're having their gridlock. Well, we had our own gridlock here only 2 years ago. So the people are a little skeptical right now of what's going on. And they still don't feel that those jobs are really there yet. And what we spoke about, and what the governor spoke about today and in the past, is about these new acquisitions and these new opportunities for employment and for jobs. Still going to take a while for that to happen. So it's a process. We still see Europe still in trouble. We see the downgrading of 14 different nations last week, and it was barely a glimmer in the markets, which I thought that was amazing. So you're starting to see people are starting to hope. They're starting to look for leadership changes here in this nation, and they're looking for opportunity for their families. And right now, they're still a little nervous and apprehensive of that movement.
Senator Golden, I want to thank you very much for your time and to ask you to return for future programs, because I'd like to continue to talk to you as we make it through the negotiations of the state budget.
Yeah. Thank you very much, John.
Thank you very much, Senator. We'll see you soon.